Of God, there is sweet manna, the blessings and goodness and graces of God poured out, and it is so good to be in the house of the Lord today and encouraging one another, seeing people, and praying for one another, and just celebrating the goodness and the greatness of God, and I hope you're here this morning to do that. We have a great time worshiping the Lord Jesus, hearing His Word, opening our eyes and our hearts to His truth, and then walking, seeking to walk in obedience to Him day by day. We're so glad you're here this morning. If you have not, or you filled out the information card that's in your bulletin, fill that out, and then you leave. If you just drop in from the offering drop boxes at the back of the sanctuary. Let me lead us in a prayer this morning. So let me pray. Father God, we come to worship you today, to celebrate just how good and how great you are, to thank you for loving us so much that you sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross, to provide for our forgiveness, our cleansing, our new birth, and the life we have in you. And so we come today, some because of that life we have in you, to worship you. Others coming seeking the truth, to understand more about who you are and your great love. And so I pray that as we're in your presence today, our minds and our hearts will be open to you, the great God, the wonderful giver of life and salvation. And it's in that name we pray.
Before we sing, I'd like to read from Psalm chapter 95 this morning. It says this: In you, Lord my God, I put my trust. I trust in you. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one hopes in you, with no one who hopes in you will ever be put to shame. But shame will come on those who are treacherous without cause. Show me your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth. And teach me, for you are God my Savior, and my hope is in you all the day long. Remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you, Lord, are good.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you, I am lifted up. Holy, 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 holy,
Heavenly Father God, we thank you, Father. May we, in the uncertain times in our lives, in the good times in our lives, may we be still and behold you as the Lord God. Father, we thank you for the cross. We pray this morning, Father, draw us near to the cross. Draw us near to you. Father, we thank you that the story doesn't end with the cross. We thank you that you rose again 3 days after. You are the one that buried death when you rose to life again. And we thank you that there is hope, there is joy, there is peace, there is life in you. It's in your name we pray.
Heard your voice and behold your love through me. God, I long to love in the arms of faith and be close with love through me. Draw me to the cross with love. Thank you.
with me to Psalm 8. Also take your sermon insert. There are other passages that are not from Psalm 8. Psalm 8 is kind of a focal idea that we're talking about this morning as we're in this series on the amazing valley of life. And Psalm 8 talks about how God has created us, He has made us, His value in the world. I'm going to read from Psalm 8, beginning in verse 1, where the psalmist says this: O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? You made him a little more than the heavenly beings, and you crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds, and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, all that swim in the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all of the earth. God is the creator. God is the one who has given life. God, it says, has crowned all human lives with honor and value and worth. And that value and worth then come upon God's creation of mankind. Once they were born and once they achieved certain development or functions in society or did things that made them worthwhile or valuable, but the value and the worth that God made all mankind to have was made by the fact of His creation of mankind. It was not dependent upon man himself, what man did to deserve it or earn it, or some stage of his development of some function of that mankind, but it was in the development and the creation of God in creating man. Our founding fathers knew the importance of life, the value of life, and they declared in the Declaration of Independence that all mankind, all human beings, had been endowed with their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and that among these are the rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. First and foremost, is the right to life. It is an alienable right. It cannot be alienated from any human being. No man is to seek to take away that which God has given. So we've been talking about this amazing value of life. It is a God thing, creation of mankind, and the worth of every human being is a God thing. And that's why we're spending so much time about this and on this subject. We've looked at a lot of different things. But this morning, as we begin, I want us to think about it. Since we've been in the news so much, it's almost in every conversation on social media, about why do people seek abortion? Why do some women get abortion? Why do some men encourage women to get abortion? Why do some politicians support it, encourage it, do things to try to make it more accessible in our society? Why? Well, you could probably give several reasons, but I've broken them down into four categories that I put on your outline. And the first one is this: ignorance. Ignorance. And I'm not using that as a derogatory term. I'm just using the sense of not knowing. There are some people who seek abortion because they do not know certain things. Some people do not know God. They do not know that God has created mankind. He has given mankind the value and the worth that is found in Him. And it's not for us to say, well, I think this is valuable, or I think that is valuable, this is not. They do not know God and what God says. We know many babies also are aborted because of lack of knowledge about life and when life begins. And we spent a good bit of time talking about throughout this series that life begins at conception, when that new, unique individual comes into being, has a different DNA. It's not a part of one's body, but it's not potential life, but it is life. It is a unique individual. It's not a clump of cells. It is science when life begins. And some people are just ignorant of that. They do not know the science. They do not know when life begins. And we're to know the truth. And it's the truth that sets us free. And so we are to share the truth and to speak the truth, because some do not know the truth in regards to life. And that's why some people either have abortions or either support the killing of the unborn. Now, second reason some people have abortions or support abortions is because of confusion or deception. Confusion or deception. The Bible speaks a lot about the confusion and deception that is in our world. For example, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4 says, "The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of God, who is the image of God." So, you know, the devil is active in our world today. And part of what he does is blind people or deceive people so they cannot see the truth. He does that about who Jesus Christ is, that Jesus is God, the Son of God. He's the Savior, the only Savior of the world. He seeks to blind people's eyes so they cannot see that. But he blinds the eyes of people to truth in other areas, and certainly in regards to life. You know, God is the creator of life. Wherever God works, wherever God does great things, the devil tries to steal, to kill, and destroy. And so he certainly tries to bring confusion and deception in regards to life. And so Colossians chapter 2, verse 8 says, "See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world, rather on Christ." He says, don't be deceived by all the untruth, the deception that's in our world. And it's a lot out there. Now, somebody once said that if you tell a lie long enough, some people will start to believe it. And we did hear some same lies over and over again that are being said in the news, social media, all sorts of places. Sometimes we even hear church people say them that are not true concerning lies. And people start to believe it. And they're deceived. They're led astray. God is not the author of confusion. God is the author of truth and life. And we who know God are not to add to the confusion, but we're to speak the truth so people are led from the confusion and deception into truth. So many people are deceived in our world. They're blind to the truth. We who know it are the speaker. And then, number three on the inside of your outline, another reason some people get abortion, some people support it, some people vote for it, is because simply hard hearts. And this is a tough one. There are people who have hard hearts. And the Bible speaks of this quite often, of how the hard-heartedness of people lead people into terrible, often awful things and behaviors. Look at this passage, Ephesians chapter 4. This puts a lot of it all in the same passage. This is why a lot of people do what they do, believe what they do in our world today. Ephesians 4, verse 17. "So, I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must not, or no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding, and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their heart. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed." So you see some of the progression there? He says we see a lot of impurity in the world. We see a lot of people taking part in behaviors that are destructive and damaging. It says it comes many times because of their ignorance, not knowing the truth, and the deception that's taking place. And you said you want to even see where that comes from? It comes from hardness of heart. And when he's speaking of hardness of heart, is talking about resisting truth. It's talking about resisting God. And that hardness, when people resist God, many times causes people to, well, when they resist God, is to embrace untruth. You know, a lot of times you'll say, how can they believe that? How can people support the killing of unborn? How can they be so insensitive? Oftentimes because of hardness of heart. They've hardened their heart against God. They've hardened their heart against truth. They've hardened their heart against those who speak the truth. You know, there's been a lot of posting on the internet in various places about how people are just, they're heartbroken over taking away this life from people and that life. And people don't have the freedom to choose what they do with their own body. And they're just heartbroken. How about being heartbroken over the taking of innocent life? See, that passage talks about the insensitivity of those who have hard hearts. When our hearts are hard, we're very insensitive to truth. And we see in our society, you know, people, oh, they're heartbroken over a lot of things, but they're not heartbroken over the truth and people's lives that are being lost through the killing of unborn children. So hard hearts bring a lot of problems, a lot of resistance to truth. And black people, many times, go against it. And one of the reasons, many times people seek abortion. Oh, let me read before I leave Proverbs 28, verse 13. Proverbs 28, verse 13. It says, whoever conceals their sin does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy. Blessed is the one who always trembles before God, but whoever hardens their heart falls into trouble. When our hearts are hard, we are in a dangerous, we are in a rocky time, and it brings heartache when our hearts are hard. And many times it takes something strong to break a hard heart. We're going to talk about this in just a moment. But then the fourth reason many times people seek abortion or make unwise decisions is because of despair and hopelessness. Despair and hopelessness. You know, a person can be in a position of hopelessness, in a position of despair, and when you're in despair, it's easy to make bad decisions. In fact, you probably heard somebody say, don't make any big decisions when you're discouraged. On Monday mornings, you know, don't make any big decisions when you're having to go back to work and you dread on that. Don't make big decisions when you've been going through a difficult time and you're discouraged about what you're going through, because it's easy to make bad decisions when you're in despair. Look in the book of Lamentations, Lamentations chapter 3, verse 17. And here it talks about a person in despair. They were discouraged. They were downcast. And it says this, I have been deprived of peace. I have forgotten what prosperity is. So I say, my splendor is gone. And all that I'd hoped from the Lord. Have you ever been there when you see somebody go through a hard time, difficulty, you don't have peace anymore, you lost part of things you hope are, don't seem to be happening, and your splendor, the brightness even of your eyes is faded away. You don't have a smile. You know, it's just because you're in despair. Things are difficult. Then he says, I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Oh, he's focusing on the hardship. He says, all I'm thinking about is all the troubles I've got. All I'm thinking about is all the problems. All I'm thinking about is how deep of a hole I'm in, and there's no way to get out. Listen, I put this on your outline as a bullet point, and I said, see, there's only no hope, and there's no Jesus. There's only no hope. The only time there's no hope is when you don't have God, when you don't have Jesus Christ. Jesus is the hope of the world. And when you're focused on Jesus, there's always hope. So let's read the rest of Lamentations. What comes right after, he says, I am downcast, I'm in despair. Lamentations 3:21. Yet, this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those who hope in him, to the one who seeks him. See, there's never no hope until you get your eyes on Jesus, off of Jesus. And when your eyes are off of God, off of Jesus, you don't see any hope. You don't see any way out. And that's why many people seek abortion. That's why many people think that's the only way out, because they don't see any other way out. You know, like as we sing that song, I think it's called Waymaker. And see, that God is the Waymaker, and there seems to be no way. He is the miracle worker, the promise keeper. He is the light in the darkness. We, as believers in Jesus Christ, are to help people see Jesus Christ. Help people see that there's hope in Christ. And regardless of our situation, God, when our focus on Him, is always working. He's always providing mercy that are new every morning. And when we're in despair, we have to turn our focus upon Jesus Christ. Now, why have I spent so much time about this? Why have I spent so much time just talking about why some people seek abortions or why some people focus on abortions? Well, it's because, or support abortions, it's because if we know what the thinking of a person is or where a person is in their stance, it helps us in talking to them. We talk to them, we're supposed to be salt, we're supposed to be light. Many times we're Christians think we're supposed to do nothing. We just, you know, to hide our light in the bush or not, how to affect the world. We don't want to turn anybody up or anything. But we're supposed to be salt, we're supposed to be light in the darkness. And so we're to interact, we're distinctively healing and help. And so how do we do that? We interact with people with the truth. But knowing where the people are helps us in knowing how to speak and talk to them. For example, Jesus, he was the light of the world. He talked with people about a lot of controversial things that were sometimes offended people. But how Jesus talked to people depended on where they were, where their heart was. For example, in Mark chapter 12, verse 18, the Bible says Jesus was having a debate with some Sadducees. Now, the understanding is that in a general conversation, this was obviously a debate. And what they were debating about, talking about, was the fact that the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection. That's why they were Sadducees. There was no resurrection, they thought. And that's how you remember that. They didn't believe in the resurrection, so they were sad. If you don't believe in the resurrection, there's reason to be sad, right? If this is all there is. And the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. And Jesus was debating them. He knew where they were. And Jesus said this to them. He said, "You error. You are in the wrong because you do not know the scripture, nor do you know the power of God." I mean, he was really soft and gentle there. Why? He said, "You're wrong. And the reason you're wrong, you do not know the truth. You do not know the scripture, and you don't know God and how God works." And so that's the way he was dealing with them. Now, I'm sure some people ran away and said, "Oh, Jesus is really being offensive by telling them they're wrong." But did Jesus hold back and say, "Well, I'm not going to say you're wrong. You know, I'm not going to say anything. I'm telling people." No, he said, "You're wrong. And the reason you're wrong, you don't know the truth, nor do you know God and how God works and who God is." Now think of another situation. Think about the often examples in the Gospels where Jesus met with the Pharisees. The Pharisees were, for the most part, not all of them, but for the most part, were legalistic, hypocritical, hard-hearted people, not only to God, but also to the truth, and that's why they dealt with Jesus so bitterly and angrily. And so how did Jesus deal with them? Well, on several occasions, he called them snakes, a den of vipers, whitewashed tombs full of dead men's bones. That's just like the way the sweet, gentle Jesus spoke to them. Yeah? That's what we need to speak like Jesus did. Yeah? Well, if he did that, you know, we would have said a lot there. But Jesus said, "You're a bunch of snakes and vipers. You're the blind leading the blind." Why did he speak to them like that? Because they had hard hearts that were resistant to God and the truth. And sometimes it takes a heavy hammer to break through the hardness of a heart. God deals with us many times in sweetness, and his kindness and mercy. But sometimes we don't respond to his sweetness and kindness. So sometimes he brings hardness to us or a difficulty in our life to get our attention. Sometimes it takes a heavy hand. But last week, I was going to plant some late tomatoes in my garden, and I went out there, and I took my shovel to dig a hole for those tomatoes. And the ground was so hard because of the lack of the softening moisture of rain. I didn't break my foot trying to get that shovel through the ground. I had to go get a pick and dig a hole in the ground with a pick to break through. And that's how sometimes God has to deal with people, in the hardness and the sternness of the truth to break through hardness of the heart. If the sweetness and the kindness don't work, sometimes you have to go a little harder. And we're not saying being ugly. Some people might think Jesus was ugly. I'm just telling you how he dealt. He dealt with people depending on where they were. Think of one more example. Think of a woman who was caught in the very act of adultery. And she was brought by some of these hard-hearted people and thrown at the feet of Jesus. They were coming to condemn her and to put her to death and wanted to see if Jesus would go along with them and say that she needs to be put to death. And they threw her at the feet of Jesus, not thinking about her, not thinking anything but what their agenda was and what they wanted to accomplish. And they said, "Jesus, what do you say?" These men, he said, "Let he who is out here among you cast the first stone." He's trying to break through the hardness of their heart and let them know nobody's without sin. But then he turned to the woman and said, "Woman, where are those who condemn you? I don't condemn you either. Go and sin no more." He was not condoning her sin because he told her, "Leave your life of sin." He said, "Woman, I'm not here to condemn you. I'm here to point you to life." She was in a place of despair, wasn't she? She was in a place of hopelessness. She had been thrown at the feet of Jesus. She deserved death. She had no hope. She was lying before him. Jesus tenderly said, "Woman, I don't condemn you. Leave your life." Okay. So he dealt with her differently than he dealt with those hard-hearted Pharisees. He dealt with them. He said, "You don't have any sin? Then you catch the first stone." They could deny that, even though they may have thought they didn't, that they were perfect. So knowing this helps us in dealing intelligently with people as we share the truth of real life in the world. And one other thing we want to talk about is the opposition to truth. So our world opposes the truth. Our world cannot stand the truth. The Bible says that men love darkness because they love darkness because their deeds are dark, and they hate the light. They resist the light. They resist the truth. When you share the truth, there'll be some opposition to it. And sometimes we think, "Well, you know, I don't want to share the truth because there'll be opponents. I don't want to rock the boat. I don't want to offend anybody. You know, I don't want them to call me names or anything if I share the truth." But we're light. We're salt. And you just need to know that there'll be some opposition. And two things that we hear so many times when we speak the truth is, on your outline there, Christians are so judgmental, or the church is so condemning. You heard that? I've heard that so many times. You know, Christians are just always so judgmental. They just judge people, and they judge people. You know, the church just condemns people. Let me say the truth about that. Let me translate it for you. I put it on your outline. When somebody says Christians are so condemning, or the church is so judgmental or condemning, now there are some people who are judgmental. There are some people who are condemning. But by and large, the church is not. Those Christians who speak the truth, they're not. But what people are saying when they say Christians are so judgmental, they're saying, "I don't want to hear the truth. I don't want to hear what's right. I don't want to hear what's wrong. I want to keep on living like I'm living. So don't speak to me about what's true because it makes me feel bad." Right? The truth will always expose darkness. And generally, regardless of even how hard somebody is, when there is the light of truth, it will spark in their heart about exposing darkness. Because what happens when truth is spoken and darkness in our lives is exposed by the truth? God has designed us so that guilt is brought up. most of us think guilt is a bad thing. Guilt is really a good thing. Because guilt, when it responds to light exposing darkness or error, guilt lets us know that there's something wrong here. Guilt is an uncomfortable feeling. And it says there's something here that needs to be taken off. The Bible says that guilt is to bring forth repentance. And repentance brings forth life. So when we're doing wrong and truth is spoken, it brings guilt. We are to respond to that guilt exposing our wrong with repentance so we have life. But some people don't want to repent. They want to, because of the hardness of heart or the resistance to truth, they want to stay in their sin. And if they say, don't speak to me truth, I don't want to hear truth because it makes me feel bad. So be quiet, Christian. You got to just expect that at that time. So when you hear, you know, the Christians are just so judgmental. Generally, call the first thing, I don't want to hear truth. I don't want to keep on living like I've been living. I mean, you say it many times. People will say that. They're living in sin and disobedience to God. And then another thing we often hear, Christians are so intolerant and so unaccepting. Christians are just intolerant. They're so unaccepting of us. Now think about this. Think about what Jesus said. Think about what's taking place in our society. You know, in our society today, we're increasingly being bombarded with sin, with lifestyles, with behaviors that are contrary to truth and the Word of God, but yet we're constantly being bombarded with it, whether it's on TV or in public or wherever, and we're flooded like on the movies and TV with all this untruth and these lifestyles and behaviors that are wrong. And why is that? Well, remember we said the devil and the spiritual forces of the wickedness are behind all of this. They scheme and they plan, and they're very smart in a sense in what is tempting to be to take place in our world and in our mind, and that is by constantly exposing us to untruth and wrong, so that we will not see it as wrong or as darkness. For example, if this morning, when you start entering the sanctuary, we had the lights just turned down really dim, really, really low. And as soon as you walk in from being outside, you walk in and you go, wow, it is dark in here. I can hardly see how to make it to my place. It is so dark in here. You come on in, you sit down, and then about 15 or 20 minutes later, you come up there and say, oh, I must have turned up the lights. I can see those cactus on the wall. I can see, you know, the vultures and the other images. It's really not that dark in here. But what happened? Did we raise the lights and suddenly get light in there? No. You kept the lights the same light, but you became adjusted to the darkness. Your eyes adjusted, and then you were able to see, even though the light was the same darkness, thinking it had become light. And so they said, oh, it's not that dark. That's what takes place in the world. Our world constantly seeks to bombard us with untruth and sin and darkness in the hope that we'll become used to it, thinking, well, so, since it's so common here so much, it must be okay. Because it's everywhere, and it's really not that bad. So the world tries to get us, and this is the point, the world tries to get Christians to accept darkness as light, to accept untruth as truth, to accept that which is wrong as right. So we'll be accepting of it. It's really surprising, but the world wants the acceptance of Christians, and there are some who want, in a strange way, God to accept or to give his okay for their wrong. And they think, well, if Christians will say it's okay or accept sin, then God must accept it. They know we have a need for God. The world knows we need God. We have an inborn a law within us given by God that we need God. We need to get here, even though people do not. We need God. And so we want to be accepted by God, but we seek to do it man's way rather than God's way. And man's way generally involves the acceptance of sin, reforming God in our image And according to our understanding, so he is like us, right in the holy, holy, holy God that we sang about. So the world says, Christians, they are so intolerant. They're so unaccepting. So I put this on your outline. It's very important. Love and approval are different things. You can love someone and not approve of what they're doing or how they're living. We're the love people. In fact, God so loved us while we were yet sinners. He loved us, not approving of how we live in our sin. He did something about it. He came and died on the cross for us so we can know Him and be brought into a transforming relationship with Him. But love and acceptance are not the same thing. We are never to accept sin. We're to love one another. Love is not acceptance. Love is clinging to what is good, rejecting that which is false, rejecting what is wrong. We love, we don't accept sin. But the confusion of the world is thinking that if you don't accept what I accept, then you're intolerant and unloving. Don't be fooled by that. Don't allow that to squeeze you into silence in speaking the truth. Just because you don't accept sin or wrong does not mean you're unloving or intolerant. Look at this verse in your outline, Romans 1, verse 32. In Romans 1, it's kind of talking about the progression of sin, the estate that it takes place in our world and individual life. And it starts out by saying, because these people reject the knowledge of the truth and of God and exchange the glory of God for other things that they worship, God gave them over to all sorts of behaviors. And then it says in Romans chapter 1, verse 32, it says, although they know God's righteous decree, that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also they approve of those who practice them. See, our world wants us to approve of those who do wrong and approve of that behavior, saying that's what it really means to love. And so many times we hear Christians say, well, I wouldn't really do such and such, but I'm not going to say somebody else can. Or I'm not going to say they don't have the right to do that. See how tricky the devil is? How he works in deception and lies? Says, we are to love, we're never to accept sin. So, the bottom of your outline says this. It is not condemnation or judgment of those who have an abortion that we speak the truth concerning life. It's not in judgment, not in condemnation of those who have had an abortion or have supported abortion that we speak truth. The truth is meant to set people free, and we're the ones who speak the truth. Is anybody here this morning? If you're here and have never received Jesus Christ, He is the hope of the world. He is the Redeemer. He is the Savior. He is the one that gives life. He is the one that transforms us into new creations. If you've never placed your faith in Him, I encourage you this morning to believe in the death, the burial, and the resurrection as the sufficient sacrifice for your forgiveness, your cleansing, and your salvation. But there are others of you here that know that your focus, your eyes, and not been on Christ, and being who He's called you to be, and acting and doing as He's called you to act. And you seek to follow in His way, being conformed to His image, rather than to the image of our world. You will be called. You will be the light. You will be used of God for His glory. You say, God, I need You. I need Your transforming work in my life. Our world needs You. That I seek Jesus. I live for Jesus. That there's a hope. Father God, we thank You that You do love us so much. You are our hope. You are our life. You are the way, the truth, and the life. And we forever, always, be speaking You, sharing You, and living for You, so that You're glorified in and through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Stand with us as we pray. Thank you. This is Vacation Bible School week. It is one of the most important weeks in the life of our church. We invite and encourage kids and some of our youth to come in to hear about Jesus. Some of these kids don't grow up in families that know about Jesus. They talk about Jesus. They sing about Jesus. And so, you know, sometimes pastors send the kids to get not to hide. But we're going to tell them about Jesus. We're going to sing about Jesus. We're going to have games. We're going to have decorations. We're even going to have snacks that point to Jesus Christ. Everything's about Jesus that we're seeking to do. Pour into their hearts Jesus Christ to go home, to talk to your brothers and sisters about Jesus, talk to your parents, to grandparents, talk to others about Jesus Christ. We plant the seed in them and we pray that God's in the harvest to increase of righteousness. Because there's nothing more important than the Word of God and the human soul. We seek to plant the eternal Word of God in the human soul so they may grow and have the life, eternal life, everlasting life, spiritual life in Christ. Many people have been working for weeks and months. Get ready for this coming week. See just the physical changes in the decorations. Many of you here will have parts during the week. We still need some folks in a few areas down the Williams. Children's Parade will be outside if you would like to help. Well, maybe not all 5 days, maybe just a few days. There's some things you can do. Also, we have CDs available for the music. The kids love music, and the music teaches them the truth. But Angel will be leading us in that. And you need, it would be helpful if you go ahead and buy your kids the music and play it this afternoon tonight, send them to bed with the music, and they'll come tomorrow knowing the songs already, hearing the songs. They'll be singing them all week, and I'm going to give them a head start, and they'll want to take it at the end of the week. Hopefully, they'll have that. But you can go ahead and get those. I think they're like 10 bucks. And then I see it. We have shirts provided. They're also, I think, 10 bucks a piece. They have all various sizes. It helps us feel a part of what's taking place and excitement of what's taking place. We can have a shirt with a theme on it. So I encourage you to pick up those as well. Here, so if you're bringing a baby, you can pick up a shirt for them and bring them. If you have not already registered your children, you can do that either online or you can do it with a hard copy coming out of the form. items for you at the table. So hope you will be here working, praying for this week, and God will use it. And I want us to do that right now. I want to lead us in a prayer, praying that God will use this week for His purposes in our ordinary and kids to Him also. Let me make sure I'm going to pray. Oh, Father God, how great Your love is for us, and how great You've shown that in many ways. You called us, Your people, to show that love, to share the truth. We seek to do that this week in Vacation Bible School. We ask that You use us as we give ourselves to You, using facilities, our abilities, and the talents of people to point people to Jesus Christ, so that they'll know You, the living Lord, the truth, the way of the life. Thank You, Father, for what You'll do. So glad you're here. Let's sing our final song before we go.
Thank you.